Set. Let's go to our title for today, Dressed for the Game. I'll tell you how we got that in a little bit. Before we get into the message today, as I was saying, it's time for us to enjoy the seventh-day stretch on our baseball theme, and we'll sing along with the words on the screen here. So, Ron, if you would get us over here, I'm going to mute my mic temporarily, and sing along with the words on the screen. So, who's this guy? Leo the Lip.
Leo the Lip.
Leo DeRoche. It's on the screen there, right? Last time I put the name up there because last time I asked this back in 2016, nobody knew who he was. So right? Like if you watched the Munsters, you've seen him, right? So, Leo the Lip was an American professional baseball player and a manager. He played in the major league as an infielder. And on his retirement from management, he ranked fifth in all-time among managers with a 2009 career victories, which was second only to John McGraw in National League history. So he still ranks 10th in career wins by a manager. So he was famous for his fiery manner on the field, and when asked why he never backed off, a trait that didn't exactly endear him to his competitors, he is reputed to have said, "Nice guys finish last." I'm sure you've all heard that saying. Probably not something you want to teach your children, but in that same vein in football, Vince Lombardi said, "Winning isn't everything, it's the only thing," right? Now, we probably tend to go to different messages with our children, like in the sports arena, like there's no I in team, right? It's not whether you win or lose, but how you play the game. And there's some truth to that, right? But how you play the game can make you win as well, right? You're on the Lord's team. So now I want to talk about Leroy Satchel Paige. So you may not have heard of him. So he played in the major leagues after he was 40 years old. But before that, he played in the Negro leagues when they were segregated, okay? So it's estimated, because nobody really knows his age, because he didn't really track that when he was younger. And there, we estimate he was born in 1906, all right? No one knew for sure. He was called Satchel because he used to work at the railroad station carrying bags for passengers. So he would be Satchel, right, and carry the bags. He started his baseball career in 1924. This will all tie to the gospel. You'll see. When he had a tryout with the Mobile Tigers, a semi-pro baseball team. Well, he was quickly named the greatest pitcher in the history of the Negro Leagues, and he compiled such feats as 64 consecutive scoreless innings, and you can compare that on the screen to the Major League tops, right? A stretch of 21 straight wins beat in Major League Baseball only by Carl Hubbard with 24 and Roy Facis with 22. And a 1-4 record in 1933. That's amazing. He claimed that he won 104 of the 105 games he pitched in 1934 as well, but records weren't as well kept. For 22 years, Satchel mauled the competition in front of sellout crowds. He liked the attention, but for him there was one goal, and that was to graduate to the major leagues and play in the major leagues. And in 1948, his dream finally came true. The Cleveland Indians were in need of extra pitching and because they were running towards the pennant. So you might have heard of this guy, William Louis Beck Jr., Bill Beck, known as Sports Shirt Bill. Now, you know him from what? Where? White Sox, right? He's a native of Chicago. So the legend tells that he tested Page's accuracy before offering him a contract. And they tell the story that Beck placed a cigarette on the ground and said, "This is home plate." And he had Page pitch over it. He fired 5 fastballs, and all but one of them sailed directly over the cigarette. So Beck was obviously pleased. He brought him into the majors, and he was the first black man to pitch in a Major League World Series. That's pretty cool, right? And he was also the first black baseball Hall of Fame inductee, and he holds the record for being the oldest rookie in the Major League. And he did help the Indians win the pennant. In addition to Cleveland, Page played for St. Louis and Kansas City. And when his Major League career was completed, in the Major League portion of his career, he had a 28-31 record with a 3.29 ERA. That's an earned run average, right? That's good for a pitcher. Kevin, right? It's good. Okay. He also served as a coach for the Atlanta Braves in 1968. But what made him so memorable was his character and his longevity in the game. The main reason his age was so difficult is when questioned, he would have comments like, "Age is a question of mind over matter. If you don't mind, it doesn't matter." So he retired in 1953. His pitching was amazing. He was kind of a showboat, you know, not quite Muhammad Ali style, but he was a showboat, and his career spanned 5 decades. He ended his, I already read that, stats, but he had the ultimate honor in 1971. He was elected to join the very best in the Hall of Fame. So he died in 1982 on June 8th in Kansas City, Missouri. And I want to share a few quotes from old Satchel. So first, I want to read a couple of things. And Dizzy Dean, some baseball greats, what they said about him. Hey, if you look at that's actually a program from Satch playing in Chicago at Wrigley Field. 10 cents you could have bought that program for. Dizzy Dean said, "My fastball looked like a change of pace alongside that little pistol bullet old Satchel shoots up the plate." Casey, the mighty Casey Stengel, said, "He threw as far from the bat and as close to the plate as anyone I ever saw." Joe DiMaggio said, "The best and fastest pitcher I've ever faced." All right, some high praise coming from these folks. And Satchel, one of the quotes that I loved about him says, "Ain't no man can avoid being born average, but there ain't no man got to be common." I just thought that was really deep. Here's a couple other. I want two more quotes from Satch. "Don't pray when it rains if you don't pray when the sun shines." Now, he wasn't overtly Christian, but this nails it, right? And obviously, it's obvious why I liked that quote, and I'm sure you like it too, because it's true, right? You know, if you're not praying in the times of plenty, right? Is he going to listen to you, you know, in the times of despair, right? Got to stay connected. But this is the one that I'm basing the title of the sermon on and the theme of it. You win a few, you lose a few, some get rained out, but you got to dress for all of them, right? So why am I telling you about Satchel Paige? Well, because that quote sets that stage for the message today. I'm pretty sure Satchel wasn't going to try and teach us about Jesus with that line. But as I reflect on the gospel, it seems that what Jesus is trying to teach us is that kind of discipleship, to always be ready, to always be prepared, to always be suited up in uniform, ready to play. So I think Satchel's quote worked very good for introducing us. I think the disciples learned about the principle of always being ready to trust the Lord and stand in the power of his might. It took them a while. But let's start our reading today here in Mark 8, verse 27. I'll kind of just read through these quickly. "And Jesus went out and his disciples into the towns of Caesarea Philippi. And by the way, he asked his disciples, saying unto them, Whom do men say I am? And they answered, John the Baptist, but some say Elijah, and others, one of the prophets. And he said unto them, But whom do you say that I am? And Peter answering said unto him, You are the Christ. And he charged them that they should tell no man of him. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and the scribes and be killed and after 3 days rise again. And he spoke that again, saying openly. And Peter took him and began to rebuke him. Lesson learned. Don't rebuke Jesus. Okay. But when he turned about and looked on his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, Get you behind me, Satan, for you're savoring not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. I don't want you to go and suffer like that, Jesus. Let's do something different. He was expecting something different. And Jesus told him that was a bad thought, right? You're not savoring the things of God. You want what you want. I want what God wants. And so we got to remember that. Back to the text. And when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said to them, Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he's coming in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. For a very long time, the apostles seemed to have absolutely no idea what being a disciple of Jesus Christ really meant. They were his disciples. He called them that. And yet, you know, we read Peter says, hey, you're the Messiah. We know this. We know this. But then in the very next set of verses, Peter failed to grasp the need for the Messiah to suffer and die. Tough concept. It wasn't given to them yet, you know, to be fair, right? And they didn't have the Spirit yet. But let's read on. And he said to them, Verily I say unto you, that there be some of them that stand here that shall not taste of death until we have seen the kingdom of God come with power. And after 6 days, Jesus is taken with him Peter and James and John, and leading them up to a high mountain apart by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. And his raiment became shining, exceedingly white as snow, like no fuller on earth can white them. Fuller, what they whited the material or whatever, canvas or what have you, and made it very white. And there appeared unto them Elijah with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter answered and said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make 3 tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. For he wist not what to say, he didn't know what to say, because they were afraid. Let's make tabernacles for you. And there was a cloud that overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud saying, This is my beloved Son, hear him. And suddenly, when they looked around, they saw no man anymore except for Jesus alone with themselves. You think they'd start to put things together and start to listen to what Jesus was trying to tell them about what they had to do, how they had to follow him, and what following him meant. And they came down from the mountain, verse 9, and he charged that they should tell no man what things they had seen, till the Son of Man were risen from the dead. Here, I'm telling you again, guys, I got to die. I'm going to suffer things, and I'm going to die. And then they cut saying with themselves, questioning one another, what does rising from the dead mean? Really? Here, the disciples, come on. And so they asked him, saying, why do the scribes say that Elijah might come first? They're trying to time this out, right? And he answered and told them, Elijah variously is coming first and restoring all things, and how it is written of the Son of Man that he must suffer many things and be set at naught. It's coming, but I tell you, Elijah has indeed come already. And they've done to him whatsoever they wanted, as it is written of him. Let's read the parallel version of Matthew and give us a little more. Matthew 17, 11 through 13. And Jesus answered and said to them, Elias truly shall first come and restore all things. But I say unto you, Elijah is come already. And they knew him not, but they've done to him whatsoever they wanted. Likewise shall also the Son of Man suffer of them. Then the disciples understood that he spoke of John the Baptist. He was the Elijah to come. Brian just brought that out a couple of weeks ago in sermon as well, right? This is the setting. Look, it's already come. Now it's time for the Son of Man to suffer. Some of the disciples saw the transfiguration, but they still didn't get what it meant. They didn't get what it meant to mean, to be a disciple. What was that? How do we have to follow him? Mark 9, verse 14. And when he came to his disciples, he saw a great multitude about them and the scribes questioning with them. And straightway all the people, when they beheld him, were greatly amazed. And running to him, saluted him. And he asked the scribes, "What question you with them?" What are you asking them? One of the multitude answered and said, "Master, I have brought unto you my son, which has a dumb spirit. And wheresoever he taketh him, and he teareth him, and he foameth and gnasheth with his teeth and pineth away. And I spoke to your disciples that they should cast him out, but they could not." And he answered to them and said, "O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him unto me." And they brought him unto him, and when he saw him, straightway the spirit tore him, and he fell on the ground and wallowed foaming. And he asked his father, "How long ago since this came to him?" And he said, "Oh, of a child, and oft times has cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if you could do anything, have compassion on us and help us." And Jesus said to him, "If you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes." And that's very key to our faith and to being a disciple. And straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe, help you by unbelief." And when Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying to him, "You deaf and dumb spirit, I charge you to come out of him and enter no more into him." And the spirit cried and rent him sore and came out of him. And he was as one dead, insomuch that many said, "He's dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he rose. And when he was coming to the house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why could we not cast him out?" And he said to them, "This kind can come forth by nothing, but by prayer and fasting." Again, another part of discipleship that they weren't grasping, that they still needed to do some self-sacrifice and spend some time with the Lord in prayer. And for difficult things, fasting. Christ fasted often. And I wonder how much stronger the faith of the Church of God would be if we did more prayer and fasting, each individually, and then together. Verse 30, "And they parted thence and passed through Galilee, and he would not that any man should know it, for he taught his disciples and said to them," here he's teaching them again, "The Son of Man is delivered into the hands of men, and they shall kill him. And after he's killed, he'll rise the third day." But they understood not that saying, and they were afraid to ask him. What's that? You ask him. I don't want to ask him. You ask. What does that mean? They saw him heal a convulsing child that nobody, including themselves, could do. And now they hear him speak again of his coming fate. But they're touched by none of that. They just want to understand stuff. They don't realize what he's saying and what he's doing. Verse 33, "And he came to Capernaum, and being in the house, he asked them, 'What was it that you disputed among yourselves along the way?' But they held their peace, for by the way, they disputed among themselves, 'Who would be the greatest?' And he sat down," he already knew this, right? "And he called and said unto them, 'If any man desire to be first, the same shall be last of all and the servant of all.'" Instead of thinking about what Christ was teaching them, they're all walking along the road arguing over who's better. "Oh, I'm going to be better. No, I'm closer to Jesus." They're full on board with Leo DeRocher and Vince Lombardi on that, right? They want to win. And they don't care about being the nice guy, because the nice guy will finish last. They're not subtle about it. I'm the guy. No, I'm the guy. They're caught up in their plans for what they want. What they want out of Jesus. So they don't see what's happening before their very eyes. Is that us? In it for what we can get out of Jesus? Oh, I didn't read that screen, did I? And as they were in the way going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus went before them, and they were amazed, and as they followed, they were afraid. And he again took the 12 and began to tell them what things should happen to him. He's continually teaching them this. Hey, this is your discipleship. I am schooling you to be ready. Right? Behold, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man is going to be delivered to the chief priests and unto the scribes, and they're going to condemn him to death. And they're going to deliver him to the Gentiles, and they're going to mock him and scourge him and spit on him and shall kill him. And the third day, he'll rise again. Simple. You understand that. I understand that. Veil's been lifted. And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, come to him saying, Master, we would that you should do to us whatsoever we'll desire. We want you to give us. Oh, Jesus of the magic lamp. Give us what do you want me to do for you? They said to him, grant us that we could sit on your right hand, on your left hand, in your glory. That's still kind of doing the greatest thing, right? Which one of us, how about both of us? We could be the greatest. And Jesus said to them, you don't know what you ask. Can you drink of the cup that I drink of and be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with? And they said to him, we can. And Jesus said to them, you'll indeed drink of the cup I'm going to drink of. And with the baptism I'm baptized with, you shall be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and my left hand is not mine to give, but it should be given to them to whom it is prepared, for whom it is prepared. Again, Mark, James, and John are caught up in their plans for what they want. What they want out of Jesus. Still asking about who's the most favored. I think this is a good example of how a great strength can be a great weakness in a different setting. Confidence can become arrogance. Discipline can become stubbornness. And I can sympathize with the apostles because I'm sometimes prone to that same kind of tunnel vision they have in missing that discipleship boat. Because it doesn't fit with their idea of following Jesus, right? I can make a plan and stick to it, which can be a great attribute at times, but it can also be a handicap, right? Because I don't like quoting John Lennon, but he said, life is what happens to you all the while you're busy making other plans, right? Failing to see that and sticking to your own plan sometimes can be the ultimate peak of selfishness. Right? You're thinking you know better. And you can't put yourself first that way. You have to put Christ first. But what he wants as a disciple, what is your goal as his servant here, as his disciple in life? It isn't until much later the disciples get it, and then they actually become disciples. And a couple weeks ago, we had Pentecost, the first fruits of the Old Testament, and that's when it began with them. Pentecost is that day, as you know, after the resurrection, when the Spirit comes over them like a wind, and the tongues like fire appeared over them, and then everything Jesus taught them just kind of came through, right? Stark clarity, right? They began to preach. And the various foreign visitors all hear them in their own language, right? When we just learned about this on Pentecost, right? But from that day, they grew in ceasing to worry about themselves and their own fate. They stopped keeping score on their own lives and started to play on God's team. They started to put God, the Father, his Son Jesus Christ, and the gospel message of reconciliation first in their lives, which they weren't doing before. They had become disciples. They made the team. They needed to suit up and get dressed for the game. The Bible only tells us a little bit about what happened to the disciples, but tradition and history kind of paints a blurry picture for some of it for us. So I want to take you through some of that. Realize that only the parts that are direct in Scripture are Scripture, right? The rest is tradition. But the point I'm trying to make here is these guys were dressed for the game. They were ready to play the game that Jesus told them. I'm going to suffer. You're going to suffer too for me, for my sake. Now, you don't hear that. You don't hear that preach. You don't hear that preach in the Church of God. You don't hear that preach by Joel Osteen, T.D. Jakes, Hagee, Copeland, you name them. Very rarely. You'll hear, there are a couple who will preach it. Sometimes they balance it with a prosperity message. So that it's like a once in a while thing, right? We're called to suffer with him and to be glorified with him, right? Don't think it an amazing thing that you're in this fiery trial, right? Peter had wrote. But yet, when we're in those situations, we think God abandoned us. He didn't. He's putting you through the fire to make you better, to make you realize that you're a disciple. And that some of us here may have to suffer for his sake, beyond just maybe losing a job over Sabbath day or something like that, to really physically be tried, spiritually tried, mentally tried. When I look at the apostles Jesus chose, I see ordinary men who learn to walk in the Spirit and do extraordinary things. They're far from perfect. I mean, they were probably less spiritually focused than Jesus would have originally desired. Yet, in spite of themselves, God used them powerfully to change the known world in one generation. They turned the world upside down. One generation. So, like I said, the Bible doesn't expressly tell about the ways that all of them died. We have to rely on historians. So let's review a couple of these. We'll begin with Peter, most well-known probably, right? The traditional knowledge of Peter's death is widespread amongst the secular and church historians, right? So he's mentioned by second century sources such as Tertullian, right? It's told that he was crucified, but that he thought himself unworthy to die the same death that Jesus died. So he asked instead to be hung upside down, and that was done in Rome. And when Jesus, Jesus asked Peter, goes, "Do you love me?" He said, "Told him, feed my sheep," and he did that three times, right? And then he told him this, right? "Verily, verily, I say to you, when you were young, you gird yourself and walk where you would. But when you're old, you're going to stretch forth your hands, and another shall gird you and carry you where you wouldst not, or where you don't want to go." And he spake this, signifying by what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he said, "Follow me." You think that was a prophecy for Peter, that he would follow him to death? And the way it says he spoke, signifying what death, you might not get that. Oh, when you're old, you're going to stretch forth your hands and be led where you don't want to go. You could say, well, look, it sounds like he died like an old man then. No, Jesus told them, this is how you're going to die. Follow me. And then our church history tells us that, he was preaching. You know he was preaching the truth. They say that Peter was crucified upside down on an X-shaped cross, because he felt unworthy to die the same way that Christ died. But he did. He drank of the cup. And he was baptized with that same baptism. Why? Because he put on Jesus Christ. He got dressed for the game. Let me go through some more of these. You're going to see they were all dressed. They were dressed. James the Great, son of Zebedee. Right? Fox's Book of Martyrs is a good historical source to get some of this stuff. Again, they don't always have original source information. So again, take those things with a grain of salt, but know this, that the Bible is true, and he told them they were going to suffer just like he did, right? So take that for what that is, okay? James, the son of Zebedee, was the elder brother of John and a relative of our Lord, for his mother Salome was a cousin to the Virgin Mary, right? So Stephen dies. 10 years later, we get a recording in the Bible of another martyrdom. There was definitely martyrdoms between them, but this is what was the next one that was recorded. There was a primitive writer, Clemens Alexandrius, historian, who told us that it ought not to be overlooked that as James was led to the place of martyrdom, his accuser was brought to repent of his conduct by the apostle's extraordinary courage and undauntedness, and he fell down at his feet to request his pardon, professing himself a Christian and resolving that James should not receive the crown of martyrdom alone. Hence, they were both beheaded at the same time, around 44 AD is what the history says. Again, in the face of persecution and danger, how you act, it's not going to be lost, especially on your, those are your accuser, right? Here, the man who accused him and got him put to death knelt alongside of him, was brought to Christ, and he's going to have a crown in the kingdom. They both got dressed. One at the last minute before going out on the field, but he got dressed. Andrew. A variety of traditions says he preached in Scythia and Greece, Asia Minor, but most historians agree that he was also crucified on an X-shaped cross. And we know he was participating in the Great Commission, bringing the gospel to the world. It is reported by, again, traditional sources, that when he was led towards the cross for crucifixion, he saluted it and said, "I have long desired and expected this happy hour." Not the kind of happy hour you want to go to. Or is it? And after being whipped and beaten by 7 soldiers, they tied his body to the cross to hold him up, to prolong his death. Because you die by asphyxiation hanging on the cross. You can't breathe. When they hold you up, it prolongs it. And that tradition says it took him 2 days on that cross to die. But tradition also says he called out to the crowd for 2 days, telling them that if they called on Jesus Christ, that they could be saved. He was sharing the gospel up to the very time of his death, not worried about his own agony, his own pain. He put on Jesus Christ. He was dressed for the game. John. So we know John was exiled to Patmos and for the word and testimony. So he was preaching as well. All kinds of stories about John and tradition and history. Tradition states that they tried to boil him in a vat of oil, and that he was miraculously delivered from that death. And then he was sent to Patmos, right? But we do know by the scriptures that that part's true. He was exiled. He was imprisoned. Tradition continues, though, that he was later freed and went on to serve as a bishop of Edessa, which is Turkey. And that he died as an old man, the only apostle reputedly to die peacefully and not martyred. And remember, that harkens back possibly to what Jesus had as a prophecy, saying, you know, what's it to you if he remains until I come? When Peter asked him, hey, what about that guy? What about John? What's it matter to you, Peter? What if he remains till I come back? You follow me. I think that was prophetic. Philip. Philip on the Sea of Galilee at Bethsaida, right? He was a friend of Andrew who brought him to Christ. According to tradition, he ministered in Parthia, Central Asia Minor, lived in Hierapolis near Colossae and Laodicea. He died by crucifixion and stoning, says tradition. He was scourged, thrown into prison, and afterward crucified. According to the historians, Philip's death was exceedingly cruel, that he was also impaled by iron hooks in his ankles, and crucified, hung upside down to die. And in 2011, they believed that they found his tomb in excavations of Hierapolis. Bartholomew. Some believe him to be the same person as Nathaniel. He was said to have preached with Philip until Philip was martyred. They say he was crucified as well in Armenia. And we don't know, you know, if he was beheaded afterwards, because the traditions mix up, right? But we do know that he suffered for the word of God and that he paid the ultimate price for his obedience to the Lord because he was dressed for the game. Matthew, the son of Alphaeus, but we have nothing else linking him with the apostle James, the son of Alphaeus, right? I mean, could be brother, could be a twin, could be a grandson, could be something else, right? He was a tax collector, right? And they changed his name to Levi, right? Matthew Levi, they called him. The Fox's Book of Martyrs says he was slain with a halberd. Those are pictures. Those are more medieval style halberds. I don't know what a first century one looked like. But I think it would be unpleasant. It was told that he was arrested in Ethiopia, that he was staked or impaled to the earth by spears, and then he was beheaded. Again, take that for what you will. We have nothing but legend about his death. But we do know that he got dressed for the game and played it to the end to glorify God and Jesus Christ. What about Thomas? The Gospel of John depicts Thomas, called Didymus, which is Greek for twin, as a pessimist and a fatalist. And, you know, he was courageous, but yet he didn't even show up at the gathering Sunday night after the resurrection. Right? And he's still known as Doubting Thomas. What a legacy. But I tell you what, when Jesus appeared to him, Thomas uttered the first confession of Jesus' divinity that we find in the New Testament. My Lord and my God, he said to him. I don't know, maybe Doubting Thomas is a little tough. Thomas apparently traveled to Babylon, modern-day Iraq, and evangelized there. Later, he preached in Persia, says tradition and history. And he began to preach, and today there are four major Christian groups, the Syro-Malabar, Syro-Malankara, the Syro-Jacobite, and the Marthomite, living in the state of Kerala along the Malabar coast of southeast India, which they use a form of Syrian in their language that they believe were taught by him. He is said to have been killed by the Brahmins in India while in prayer by stones and darts, and then run through with a lance because he preached the gospel and taught it to men and taught them to also preach. James Alphaeus, also known as James the Less, right? Not because he was less than the other James, but maybe he was younger or shorter, right? Maybe not as well known. But he wasn't less in God's eyes. God's not a respecter of persons. They say that he was thrown from, he was martyred in a similar fashion to James, the half-brother of Jesus, who was thrown from the pinnacle of the temple and then beaten to death. So this is not that... Some people confuse that James with the half-brother Jesus. This one is not, in my opinion, because back then in John 7, his brethren didn't even believe in him, believe he was a Messiah yet. So, although it could have happened afterwards. But so this guy was thrown from the temple and then beaten to death because he got dressed for the game and they didn't like the team he was on, what he represented, what he preached. So they killed him. Simon the Zealot. Very little known outside the Bible. Simon the Zealot, also or the Canaanite, because the word Kananos is means the zealot. All that's known about his death is from tradition, that he also was crucified. They say, according to the Catholic Western traditions, they say he died by crucifixion with Jude. Some accounts say he was sawn in half, but all accounts agreed he got dressed for the game and paid the ultimate price. Judas, the son of James, also known as Labaius, Thaddeus. This is not Iscariot, the Judas not Iscariot. It is told he evangelized in Syria and Persia and was crucified by the Magi. They say he was clubbed to death, and then his head was shattered with a broad axe. But all the traditions that, even though they disagree a little bit, they say that it was done because he refused to deny his faith in Christ. A couple more. Matthias. 14th century historian Nicephorus. I think that's how you pronounce it. Died. He says he died by crucifixion, that he was crucified in Colchis, which is the modern nation of Georgia, not the state of Georgia. A 17th century historian came up with a different scenario. He thought he was stoned and then beheaded in Jerusalem. So, but a lot of historians confuse Matthias and Matthew. So take that for what you will. But again, know this. He was a disciple. And he learned to suffer for the sake of the gospel, just like Christ came to do at the order of his Father. What about Mark? John Mark, right? The nephew of Barnabas. Let's see. History says that he was martyred after being dragged by horses through the streets until he was dead. And that was done in Alexandria. Then Luke is supposed, through tradition, to have been, and this is by Fox's Book of Martyrs, once again, have been hanged on an olive tree by the idolatrous priests of Greece for preaching the gospel. They called it sorcery. And he was killed for the sake of the gospel. So here's a little story from the Coptics. They said that after the martyrdom of Peter and Paul, that Luke went through Rome preaching, and those who worshiped the idols and the Jews in Rome agreed that they went to Nero, the emperor, and accused Luke of teaching men his sorcery. So Nero commanded that St. Luke be brought before him, and when St. Luke knew that he was going to be brought before him, he gave all the books that he had to a fisherman and told him, take these and keep them, for they will be useful to you and show you God's way. When Luke came before Nero, the emperor asked him, how long will you lead the people astray? And Luke said, I am not a magician, but I am an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. The emperor commanded the men to cut off his right hand, saying, cut off the hand which wrote the books. The saint replied to him, we do not fear death, nor the departure from this world, and to realize the power of my master. So he took up his severed hand, and he made it reattached to its proper place, and then he separated it again. Those who were present marveled at the head, and the head of the emperor's cabinet and his wife believed, as many others, and it said they numbered 276 people who believed by that alleged miracle. So the emperor, being who he was, wrote their decree and ordered that all their heads be cut off together, along with that of St. Luke. Thus, their martyrdom was completed. Take it for what it will, but again, people were ready to die for the gospel's sake. Barnabas. History says that he was brutally beaten, stoned, and burned with fire. Again, got dressed for the game. Two more. James, the brother of Jesus. He's written about in the Antiquities of the Jews, right? And Josephus, the historian, wrote about him. And he even says that he was delivered to be stoned. I'm not going to read that to you. It's on the screen. And then finally, the Apostle Paul. So you hear the love and passion of Paul in his letters and his words to Timothy, right? When he wrote and said, you know, hey, remember, nobody came to support me, right? I don't want it to be held against them, but the Lord was by me. The Lord strengthened me. He delivered me from the lion's mouth. You know, he's going to rescue me from this. You know, he thought he was going to be sentenced to death. Most church historians do say that he was beheaded. And you know that his final thoughts would have been on the Lord and what he had done for him. And he ran his race. Many others have followed in the footsteps of these men. You hear stories from Christian martyrs, right? Polycarp, John Wycliffe, William Tyndale, Jim Elliot, Richard Wurmbrand, countless Christians, when threatened with death, chose Jesus. Consult Fox's Book of Martyrs. That's one source. There are many others. But not every Christian will die because of their faith, at least not in the sense that they'll be killed physically for it. God doesn't intend for every believer to live the exact same life. Some will die the death of a martyr. And it's a death of honor. Precious in the eyes of the Lord are the death of the saints. Still, others will not. But they are called, all of us are called to suffer loss for Christ's sake in some way. I thought about the testimony, the tent of the testimony of old. And looking up the word martyr, because they were killed for their testimony. Looking up the word martyr, that's what it, that what it is. They were a witness. They were martyrs, martyred because they witnessed for Jesus Christ. Not every Christian will be put to death for their faith. Martyrdom. But all of us are called to give our lives in a witness to the gospel as living sacrifices, Romans 12, 1 and 2. Living sacrifices. Do we sacrifice our own lives? Or are we still living it like the disciples did at first? Our own means. I want this. I want that. I want that. Not concerned about the kingdom and what the kingdom wants, what God wants. What Jesus Christ wants. When I read about these early apostles, and I got to say, I was in awe of what they went through. Because it's one thing to read through it, you know, briefly. But when you spend some time on this and you see saint after saint that was and now ain't. I'm in awe of what they did. Not bad for a group of fishermen from Galilee. Countless men and women served Christ faithfully and sacrificially and at serious risk to their lives. We may not be apostles, but can we serve Christ less faithfully and less obediently than they did? So I want to ask you, what is your testimony? What is your testimony about Jesus Christ? And it doesn't have to be the bottom of the barrel story. Oh, I was a murderer, a drunkard, liar, bottom of the barrel. It doesn't have to be that. Because he's done a great thing in every one of you. If so, you have been baptized and put on Christ. The gospel of suffering. You know, I don't hear it preached enough to prepare God's people. Do you care in the present day in a typical month? And these are older stats. Over 300 Christians are killed because of their faith in a typical month. Over 200 church properties destroyed. I think those numbers are increasing since I pulled these from Open Doors USA, if you wanted to go look that. Nearly 800 forms of violence, such as rape, arrests, and beatings, will happen to people because they believe and testify in Jesus Christ. What's your problem? Do we not have it because we don't testify? Because we don't have a testimony? Think about it. Again, I'm here to encourage you guys. I'm not here to belabor anybody, right, and put anybody down. My job as a servant of the Lord is to lift you up. And I can't do that if I don't preach what he preached, that we need to be ready to suffer. In this life you will have tribulation, but be of great cheer. I've overcome the world. How did he overcome it? The same way he went. He said, pick up your cross, that's an instrument of death, and follow me. We want to pick it up and dance off to the promised land, but we don't want to follow him to death first. Except a corn of wheat fall to the ground, right? Jesus said in John 15, if the world hate you, know that it hated me before it hated you. Does the world hate you? Something to think about. If you were of the world would love its own. But because you're not of the world, but I've chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Is that true of you? Maybe you're not dressed for the game. Remember the word that I said to you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they persecuted me, did they? Did they persecute him? Then they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they'll keep yours also. But all these things they're going to do to you, why? For my name's sake. Because you have to be testifying about him for that to be for his name's sake. Why do they do it? Because they don't know the God the Father, the one who sent him. Mark 8, 34 through 38. And when he had called the people to him with his disciples also, he said to them, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself. Maybe you denied yourself an extra plate at the buffet. Oh, buffets aren't open anymore. Are you denying yourself? In what way? Are you submitting your will to his will? Whosoever shall save his life shall lose it. Whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. For what is the profit, man, if you get everything else, but you lose your soul or salvation? What will you give in exchange for that? I know what Jesus gave. Whosoever will be ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation. Wait a minute. This is an adulterous and sinful generation. Why would you be ashamed in this? Why does he mention it that way? Because you're supposed to be preaching about sin and repentance. Right? That's the message of the kingdom. Repent, the kingdom of heaven is near. It's upon you. It's at your door. But if you're ashamed of him, he says, I will be ashamed of you when I come in the glory of my Father with the holy angels. And that's not something we want to see. That's not something we want to think of. We want to hear that well done, good and faithful servant, right? Got to get dressed for the game then. Gospel of suffering, right? We told you before we should suffer tribulation as it came to pass, right? This is, Paul and his band of merry men, right? Second Thessalonians, right? That you may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you also suffer. Would you have signed up for the gospel if that's what you thought it was at first? He did it for you. Did you not realize when he said, pick up your cross and follow me, that meant to possibly to death? We also labor and suffer reproach, 1 Timothy says, right? 2 Timothy, I suffer trouble, but I have to endure all things. Why? Because if we suffer with him, we shall also reign with him. And 2 Timothy 3:12 says it all. All that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. It's not the easy life that we all want. You want the easy life or you want the holy life? You want the life eternal that Christ promised us? quite a bit of scriptures talking about suffering. How come you don't hear it from the pulpit more often? Right? Romans 8, 17 and 18, right? You're heirs and joint with God if you suffer with him, that you might be glorified together with him. And the sufferings of this present time aren't worthy to be compared with the glory that's going to be revealed in us, right? Philippians, right? Not only are you given to believe in him, but you are to suffer for his sake. Are you ready? Are you dressed? Philippians 3:10, right? I want to know him, the power of his resurrections, and fellowship. I want to be hand in hand with him in sufferings and be made conformable to his death. 2 Corinthians, in tribulation, in the sufferings of Christ abound in us. And if we're afflicted, it's for you. Right? And you're going to endure the same sufferings we suffer. Know this, if you are partakers of the suffering, you'll also be partakers of the consolation. Promise of God. Countless scriptures. But wait, there's more. Right? Colossians, right? I rejoice in my sufferings for you, right? The afflictions of Christ in my flesh for my body's sake, which is the church. I do this for you, for the church. I'm willing to suffer in that so you can see that this is the way to go. Christ suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow in his footsteps. Pretty clear. That's a clear message. And when he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself that he that judged righteously. There's a danger for us. Where some of us may be ready to suffer, but then when it happens, we're going to act out of flesh instead of out of the spirit. We got to be like that lamb to the slaughter. Don't be wise in your own eyes. Because if you suffer for righteousness' sake, you'll be happy. Don't be afraid of them. Don't be afraid of what they can do to your body. For it's the will of God if you suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. Because Christ also suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. And we hope for that same thing. I talked about the fiery trial that's going to try you, that you're partakers of Christ's suffering. You're going to be reproached for the name of Christ, but that should make you happy, not afraid. The joy, he endured the cross for the joy set before him. If any man suffers as a Christian, don't let him be ashamed, but glorify God. Let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing, as unto a faithful creator. He's faithful to you. Be faithful to him. And Revelation 2:10 tells us, fear none of those things that you shall suffer. Behold, the devil shall even cast some of you into prison that you may be tried, and you'll have tribulation 10 days or years. Be you faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown of life. That's heavy. That's a heavy message. And we should be better prepared for it because we should be talking about it more. And if we're reading our Bibles, that's quite a few verses in there, aren't there? We've got to suit up. Imagine that you're sitting in front of your TV. Oh, some of you are. But you're all ready to watch the football game, and you look up and you see the San Francisco 49ers take the field. They're dressed in their uniforms, their helmets, and you can tell by their looks they have all their safety equipment, their pads. They're ready for the game. The camera scans over to the other side of the field, and you see the Chicago Bears. But they're all in street clothes. Some are wearing shorts and T-shirts. Some are in sport coats, dress pants, dress shoes. Nobody has pads on, helmets. That would make for an interesting game, wouldn't it? However, pretty sure the Bears would lose that one, with or without pads. But in that scenario, why? Because they would not be equipped to play the game. There would be more injuries because they don't have the right equipment. They would have failed to suit up for the game, and it would have left them vulnerable. The Christian experience is kind of similar. So often we attempt to dress for battle, but we put on the wrong clothes. In the book of Ephesians, the Apostle Paul paints a picture of how the gospel of Christ is the very thing that prepares a Christian for battle, much like the armor a Roman soldier wears for battle. If we fail to suit up for the game of life, we're going to be left vulnerable to all kinds of spiritual injuries to ourselves. Ephesians 6, starting in verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, against the rulers of darkness of the world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. You're seeing a lot of that stuff going on now. If you got one eye open, you see it. Okay? Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand the day of evil, and having done all, to stand. Therefore, stand, having your loins girt about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. So I broke these down real quick. You got to suit up with the truth. So the belt of truth, you know, held the Roman soldier's tunic in place, kept the breastplate up. It helped support it. You know, I've worn one. I know that that's what it helps do that. It was also able, you were able to also tuck your clothing into it so you can move and run faster. And a lot of people go, the truth, here, this is the truth. And this is the truth because it tells you about the truth. Jesus Christ is the truth that's talked about here in the armor of God. I can't put this on and have it protect me. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And we're told the truth is in Jesus earlier in the same book of Ephesians. The belt holds the soldier's armor together, and the truth of Jesus' life and death and resurrection hold us together. Without Jesus, the other aspects of our faith would fall apart. We know the truth about the gospel of Christ, so we don't have to guess what our future is. You are written in the Lamb's book of life, and you can rejoice in that. Scripture says that. The belt of truth frees us to live the kind of life God intends for us to live. So suit up. Righteousness, the breastplate. Breastplate's the only thing standing between the enemy and the soldier's heart. It's the breastplate of righteousness. And we receive that at salvation in Christ. Because of Jesus' death, the Father sees us in right standing. Jesus is our intercessor. He fights for us. Being justified freely by his grace, Romans 3, through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and a justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. In Philippians 1:11, being filled with the fruits of righteousness which are by Jesus Christ. When you put on Jesus Christ, you put on his righteousness. Both his righteousness and then by him living through you, you produce righteous fruit. See that little Chinese diagram there? Kind of neat. The first one is a symbol for lamb. The second one is me. You put the lamb over the head of me on the top, and that's the symbol for righteousness. Pretty cool. The shoes of the gospel of peace. Jesus is our peace. Suit up. So many Christians I know are being tossed to and fro, especially with all the goings on today. Not having that peace that passes all understanding because they're forgetting who they are in Christ. Again, we have his righteousness. Oh, I got the same verses up there for you. Well, let me read you what I have written in my notes. Romans 5:1. Therefore, being... unless I just have it written there. No? Okay, Romans 5:1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And then John 14:27. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, I give unto you. Don't let your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. You know, the shoes of a soldier provide a firm footing for battle. Jesus provides peace between the Christian and God, as well as peace in the middle of a world filled with sin and suffering. The gospel of peace means we should be preaching that gospel, right? You are bringing it. Beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel, right? Of peace. Let's read the rest of that Ephesians passage. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And as he continues in verse 19 and 20, as for me, Paul, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. And I think we all should have that boldness and readiness to speak. That readiness means we have to be dressed for the game. So we got to suit up with faith. Galatians 3:22, scriptures concluded all under sin, but that promise by faith of Jesus might be given to them that believe. All this armor depicts Jesus Christ. You're all the children of faith. Well, how? By faith in Christ Jesus. Jesus is the author and finisher of our faith, right? Examine yourself whether you're in the faith. And you got to know that Jesus Christ is in you unless you're a reprobate. If you're not bearing the fruit, for you're all children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you have been baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. Fruit of the Spirit is also faith. That's the fruit of his Spirit. The shield of faith. The shield of a soldier is a barrier between the soldier and the attacks of the enemy, right? They would take that shield that was usually metal or hard wood, and then they coated it with layers of soft wood, like a plywood, and then leather, and they would soak that in water. So when a very dangerous weapon of the enemy was a fiery arrow, an arrow with, you know, dipped in tar scent of fire, it would hit into that, the soft wood would catch it, and then the moistness of the wet leather would quench that dart, right? Quench that fiery dart, we have to have that shield of faith up. Because the devil will attack. And the world and everything that's going on requires us to stand in our faith. That faith is Jesus Christ. Put him on. Suit up. He's also our salvation. The helmet, right? Protect your head. I heard you saying that, right? Protect your head. Your thoughts. But Christ is our salvation. It's not a helmet. It's not anything that you can do yourself. God has appointed us not to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. I endure all things for the elect's sake, so that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. That's what we're all striving for, right? And then the 1 Thessalonians verse also talks about that helmet, which is the hope of salvation, and then the promise God hasn't appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation. Spirit, the sword of the Spirit. Again, I know about you, but I've often grabbed that Hebrews 4 verse and said, that's this. Let's sword fight. It's talking about a person. Not talking about this. You don't believe me? Let's read that. Well, first, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The Word of God is John 1:1, is it? Hebrews 4:12 through 14. For the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing unto the dividing sunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the hearts. That's Jesus Christ, my friend. Neither is there any creature that's not manifest in his sight. That's a person. Neither is there any creature that's not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him, a person with whom we have to do. Seeing then we have a great high priest, a person, that has passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, that's the person. Let us hold fast our profession of faith. See Isaiah 49 as well for more on that. Jesus said in John 6:63 that the words he speaks are spirit and they are life. His words and the words that he would give was given are life to us. The sword of the Spirit, praying in the Spirit is another thing that follows that, right? He gave us the ability to pray by tearing that veil. Very important. The soldier's only offensive weapon was the sword, right? I mean, that we read about in that scenario. But the word for us means much more than just quoting a scripture to beat the devil. Because the scripture without the faith of the person who it's written about does nothing. It doesn't have the power. Satan quoted scripture to Jesus. It didn't have the power to take him down. Well, you can say, well, he quoted the scripture rightly. No, it's he had faith in his Father and therefore was able to quote the scripture to back that up. It's all about his faith there. The soldier puts on his armor for battle. We have to put on Jesus Christ, so we have to suit up. The Apostle Paul told us, basically, suit up. Put on the armor of God. Because life's not a playground, it's a battleground. As a Christian, you're in a battle. Whether you like it or not. You might be I'm a spiritual pacifist. Okay, then you're going to die. I mean, you're going to be defeated by the devil. I mean, we're all going to die one day. But you're going to be defeated because you don't have your armor on. You got to put your armor on. You have to be able to use your sword and march forward. You have to wake up, sober up, and suit up. Saints, wake up, sober up, and suit up. Romans 13:10-14. Love is working no ill to his neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Don't go with wishy-washy love. Love is in truth. The Father is love. God is love. Therefore, Jesus Christ is also love. Fruit of the Spirit, agape love is one of the main facets of it, right? So you got to know what that is. You also have to be a lover of the truth. And that, knowing the time, that it's now high time to awake out of your sleep. Saints, I'm shaking you awake right now. Wake up! For our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Here we are. Let us cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Who's the light? Jesus is the light. And who else is the light? He said, you are the children of light. You are the light of this world. Where's your light? You're letting the darkness overcome it? Turn on that light. Jesus Christ. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness and chambering and wantonness and strife and envying, but put you on the Lord Jesus Christ. And don't make provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. Are you more worried about yourself and what you're going to get and what you're going to be? What position you might have in the kingdom, that might not even come to your mind. We thought that was bad for the disciples to think that, but if we're not even thinking of the heavenly things, are we in a better place or a worse place than they were? At least they were putting their faith in the heavenly. Every day. Let me read a J.B. Phillips translation for the Romans 13 verse. This is really good. Every day brings God's salvation nearer. The night is nearly over. The day is almost dawned. Therefore, let's fling away the things that men do in the dark. Let us arm ourselves for the fight of the day. Let us live cleanly as in the daylight and not in the delights of getting drunk or playing with sex, nor yet in quarreling or jealousies. But let us be Christ men from head to foot and give no chances for the flesh to have its fling. That's what God says to you and to me. That's how we're supposed to live. I'm calling for each of you to put on Christ. To put on Christ by knowing him through the scriptures. To put on Christ by walking in the righteousness that he's earned for us. To put on Christ by putting our faith and our trust in him. To put on Christ by trusting that he's better than what the world has to offer us. To put on Christ by finding rest in knowing that Jesus has given us peace with God through his reconciling, selfless sacrifice. And may we all put on Christ by receiving the love, the grace, and the salvation that God's extended us through Christ Jesus, our Lord and our King. We've seen that the early disciples didn't understand what it meant to follow Christ, that they actually had to become disciples. And it began with Pentecost. Yeah, from that day on, they stopped worrying about themselves and their own desires. They stopped keeping score in their lives, and they put the message of the gospel first. When are you going to stop keeping score of your life and put the message that you were given first? Whenever I have moments of doubt in my faith, and we all have them, it's okay to admit it, I try to remember this transformation that these uneducated men who were at one point fearful and cowering behind locked doors, from the day of Pentecost forward, they went out there and they spoke the word in a way that changed the world forever. And it changed for us, even down to our time. They each went to their grave, all of them martyred for their faith, never backing down. They did not deny him. Peter learned that lesson the hard way once. People don't do that for a lie. They just don't. From that day forward, on that day of Pentecost, the captain of the team gave them their uniforms. And that day, from that day forward, rain or shine, win or lose, they always got dressed for the game. Yeah, they made plans, and they won some. Their faith grew by leaps and bounds under their guidance. They lost some. There were many who were unconvinced or turned back from the word once given to them. But no matter how hard they tried, sometimes their plans got derailed by the things out of their control. They got rained out. But now they got it. They saw that these moments, they saw them for what they were, opportunities to spread the gospel and for discipleship. Toss Paul in prison. He'll preach to the guards. Send him before kings. He'll teach them the gospel. The opportunities were different from what they planned, perhaps, but they were opportunities nonetheless. And with the right attitude, the Holy Spirit, that post-Pentecost attitude, if I could say that, they were ready. They were ready. They were dressed for the game, and they took advantage of all the circumstances that came at them. I think Jesus could tell Leo DeRocher that nice guys might finish last, but his disciples volunteer to finish last so others can get ahead. Someone once described discipleship as holding the door for others so they can go through. I also think Jesus would tell Vince Lombardi that winning might indeed be the only thing, but his disciples know that real winning and losing has nothing to do with a score kept on a football field. I think he would tell us just what Satchel Paige did. You win some, you lose some, and some are rained out. But you always get dressed for the game. So as we go forward in this walk together, in this walk of faith, let's be ready. Times are nearer than ever. Because your next discipleship opportunity, your next opportunity for your testimony is coming. It's right around the corner. And probably not where you think. It may turn out great, may end up tragically bad. But if you're not dressed and ready, it'll surely pass you right by. And that would be far more tragic. So I'll see you out there on the field. Thanks for listening to me.